Good morning, everyone. I'm Nicholas Lubush. I work mainly for a company called Apace Systems. We're working in the medical aid industry where we're the middleman between the service providers and the medical aid. So your, for example, the electronic claims from the pharmacy will be sent to us. We will pass it on to the medical aid, and the response from the medical aid will then be passed back to the pharmacy so that the pharmacist can tell you what your co-payments are or why a claim was rejected. So we're playing basically like a post office in between the medical aids and the service providers, doctors, hospitals. Okay, so today I'm gonna talk to you about a new, or it's not, I don't think it's not that new, but it's an alternative to PG Admin 3. I don't know how many of you like or don't like PG Admin 4. That was my main reason for switching or looking for something else. At that point in time, when I looked at the PG Admin 4, I didn't really fit into the way I want to work, and I came across dBeaver. So this is about what dBeaver does versus what I've done on PG Admin 3. I'm not going to even compare it to PG Admin 4 because I don't use it anymore. Okay. Okay, PG Admin 3, as you know, has stopped support for any major versions after Postgres 10. With dBeaver, we can actually manage a lot of other relational database systems as long as there's a JDBC driver, or some of them even can use an ODBC driver if you have to. They have an enterprise version that actually also allows you to connect to the NoSQL databases, which also makes it handy if you have to work on multiple database systems at the same time. Like I said, dBeaver does everything that I've done with PG Admin 3 before, and even in some cases I think it does a few things better than what PG Admin 3 did. Then also, dBeaver is based on the Eclipse development platform or IDE. So there's a lot of extra plugins and extensions that you can install. Some of them include, for example, your version control plugins you can install. There's plugins for SVG graphics. There's even a plugin for Office integration. So you can export data directly into Excel or Word document or whatever you prefer to do. Okay, just a few things. Right, with PG Admin 3, it allowed me to do different color connections so that I know on which of the different systems I am. The top, the blue ones there is production. Yellow is a test environment, then the development environment at the bottom. What I do have against it, this is the only place where you see, we'll see the color highlighted. If you're in a query window, you actually don't know on which database or environment you actually are. With dBeaver, it makes that color more obvious in a lot more places. These are the same connections that I've got there, also different colors, but now in my result window here at the bottom as well, and there on the tab bar, is the same color. So I know this is results out of my development environment, and the top bar there allows me to also change environments quite easily. So I immediately know on which environment I'm working on. Okay, changing active connections. If you're in a query window in PG Admin 3, I mean, that was your option. Your currently connected database, and then it will give you a new connection. You have to re-log in again, and it will establish new connections and do whatever it has to do. With dBeaver, they actually give you, it lists that same connections that I've already set up. And you can choose the connection you want to connect to. If you haven't got an established connection to that database yet, it will actually ask you for a password and you can connect and carry on working as if nothing has happened. So you can run the same query on three or four databases in a matter of seconds without having 3 or 4 query windows open, because I mean, every time, that's what I did with PGAdmin 3. If I need to run a query on a different database or environment, I actually used the separate query window to keep it separate. Okay, viewing data, there's not really a big difference here. That's just I'm using a dark theme for dbeaver. That's the only, basically the real difference there. There's nothing there that the one doesn't show that the other one does. Okay, but this is the one thing that I think makes a big difference with dbeaver. By default, you have an ERD diagram available for your tables. That doesn't exist in PGAdmin 3. I haven't seen any other open source tools really that give you a proper ERD diagram. Okay, this is only for the relationship I was using on the address table. We're going to work with this address table a bit more. But this is the relationships to the address table. If you go into a schema, you can actually see the whole ERD for the schema as well. But then that thing gets a bit cluttered. But I mean, you can export it and view it in a different application. And that's, for example, one of the reasons why you can install the SVG plugin, because you can export that diagram then as a SVG graphic and go and zoom and do with it what you want in another application, for example. Okay, DDL. Basically the same thing there. On the table, you can get the DDL for that. The same thing here on the site. They even make a distinction between different types of the DDL, that you can get your triggers and functions and what else is the your indexes and stuff. So you got all of them in one window, or you can just see the individual ones if you want to. That's that. Okay, SQL generation. I mean, this is the standard stuff. They just want to keep in mind, I'll show you, we'll get back to this one again, or when it's the insert into query on the other one, I also want to compare it against it. But I mean, that's the default stuff that you get from PGAdmin 3. Nothing there really. Okay. See, now this one already actually sort of allows you to see what's the data types. With PGAdmin 3, there weren't any quotes. It would have been it will be more difficult to know what the data types is if you don't know it. There's other examples as well as we'll get to. There's just maybe the one thing that I not totally agree with them is when you update and delete, to use the default, that's a default value assigned to a column. Okay, now we don't want to increase the sequence when we delete or update the record, because this is actually what it's going to do. So just be careful and change that if you do use that. Right, if you copy data out of your data grid view, there's a few options that you can set on how your values should be quoted, if you only want strings quoted, your quote character, your separators, displaying of null values, your thousands, separators, and if you want to copy your column names or not. Okay, dbeaver's got the exact same options there. I think the only thing that they added there is, for example, your row numbers that you can copy with it if you want to. But again, those are the same default values. Now, this is where things get a bit better, I would say. dbeaver's got this advanced copy thing, and there you've got a list of it can CSV, DB unit, a lot of different formats. By default, you can get that information in that format very quickly, and not something that PGAdmin offers us. there's just a few examples of what it looks like. There's the DB unit. I mean, HTML, they even go and add style sheets in here I haven't actually looked at what it looks in the browser, but they probably just to mimic the display that you see on the data grid view. There's your JSON representation of that same row. So if you need to copy data from one database to another one, or however you want to copy it, or use it in an application, Markdown if you need to, say, put it on your README page, on your GitHub pages. And there's just the normal standard SQL value as well. And what I liked about this one as well, remember, sometimes if you copy or do an insert statement, they will automatically try and generate your primary key. Here they left it out. So there's no primary key value in here because I assume it's because there is a default value specified on that column, so they don't put it in your insert statement. So that makes it easy to use that statement and go and run it against multiple databases. And that's the text representation if you use the normal PSQL client. XML, they even define the different columns there, but not really, that data doesn't help us much there, that's in that DTD, but there's all your data in the XML format. Okay, now I'm going to try and show you a few things in dBeaver itself. So I'm going to filter on a row. Come on. Not sure why that one didn't want to work with me now. So filtering of data, there's a few ways you can do that. In pgAdmin as well, you can normally just select a column and say filter by this value. The same thing does apply with dBeaver, but what I like about it is if you filter data, it gives you a lot of other options as well. So you can say filter that address by that value, filter all the addresses that's different from that value. There's a greater less than, or even if you want to use a like query. I mean, to do that type of filtering, you have to go and type that SQL in the filter window on pgAdmin. You can even then give it custom values if you don't want to use a specific value. There's all the operators again. And even if you add a value in your clipboard, you can use, say, let's say for example you had a value copied from an previous address, you could actually use that value that's in the clipboard directly. Okay, so let's say we're gonna filter on cell value Northern Cape. Let's see. Okay, there's only that one address listed for the Northern Cape. Okay, I just need to get back to my slide here quickly. Okay, now So let's say now I want to change the filtering again. Let's say, what can we change? Okay, I want to now say, okay, let's try England there. So in District England, we want to see everything for England. Right, there's a few values there. But now I actually want to go back and see the values that I've had previously in one of the other filters. Okay, so this DBeaver doesn't forget some of your filters that you've used. You're going to actually, here on the right-hand side, actually go back and go back to your previous filter. And now, where's my other one? Okay. So I can do Hamilton. Come on. And now I can go back and forth with the filters. Okay. Another thing that I actually quite like about it is when you have foreign keys on your tables and you want to filter to a different, or you want to see a value on that foreign key. Now that city ID there is just an ID to another table. Okay, but I've got no idea what 449 means. Now it allows you to do a filter filter by value. Now if you use this, it will actually go and do a lookup. And instead of just showing 446, I can now see what is all the actual city names then linked to that value. So 446 is where is it now? 446. Okay, so nothing there. But now I can quickly go back. Oh, it was 449, sorry. But this allows me to do things like that. What it also does, on the right hand side, there's a defined description. Now you can change which values are displayed in that lookup. So it will try and guess a default value for you, but nothing stops you from, say, I want to see the country ID as well. Okay, now and then it adds that value there as well, or you can change the order. If you want to first see the country ID, you just need to deselect that column again and select it, and it will change the order. Here at the bottom, it actually displays the order in which those values are displayed. Let's see, Abu Dhabi, also nothing. Okay, now I want to show you on this address database. Right, there's a last update column that is a timestamp. But that's, let's say for example, you actually store that timestamp as the epoch value. So you've got the value, a milliseconds value there that's huge that no one knows what it actually means. So I'm just going to quickly add a column there that will be the epoch value of that timestamp. Why not? Public address, last update, it's fine. Okay. No, that's not what I'm looking for. Not last. It's not gonna public address does not exist. Public address query execution. That's not the one. That is a refresh. Okay, that's now a pity that that doesn't work. But I can, let's see, I'm now actually gonna go. Okay, that value, okay, so there's a column view on, if you right click on a column, there's a column view option that allows you to change how you display that data type. Now this one I've already changed to an epoch time, but the default value just changes it back. You see, so that's a timestamp there that you, no one knows. So that I find actually quite nice that you can go and change this view. And you don't have to do it every time, you just do it once, it will actually remember which columns you change. So now I'm just going to say, go, but show me the epoch time, and then I actually got a readable timestamp from that. Okay, then let's get rid of the filters. Okay, if you've got, a lot of rows or columns on your table, and you need to, you can go scroll right and left and up and down with it. But if you want to see more that, for example, that same row, if you press tab, it will actually just change your view and show it to you in a single column, so you could see all your values in a different format. Okay, now if just a few shortcut keys if you do need them. I like to use okay, this is default settings. If you use Alt up and down, you'll see it will actually jump between the queries. Okay, so that makes it easy to select one, for example. To execute that query, you can press Control Enter and you'll get that error message again. What it's also, what you can also do is every time you execute a query and you get different results, but you don't want to lose your other results, you can use Control Backslash and it will, I don't think this is now going to work. Yes, it did. So you see there's now a second tab. So every time if you want to, you can then say compare results between the two queries. So Control Backslash will execute it and give you a new tab for it. Then if you're on your data grid view, the shortcut key for filtering is F11. It will then you can go there quickly, or if you want to do on foreign keys, Control F11 will show you that dialog again to choose your value from there. To change the active connections in between your for your databases, this is one that I've actually assigned to it. So I use Control 9 to change the active connection. Okay, there's something wrong today. But that one dialog I showed you earlier is the dialog to change the connections with where the colors were on the dialog box of the different connections. Right, I was only given the initial 20 minutes, but I see we've gone over that 20 minutes by now. Any questions? I know there's no one speaking after me, that's why no. Questions? Yes.
I use dbeaver, but I couldn't find the place where you can define the colors on your different connections. How do you do it?
Okay, let's see if we can quickly get there. Should be connection, edit connection. Must be. I must just miss. Connection type. Okay, that's a local connection. Here you can edit it. You can add your different colors. So let's say add there you can give it then your type, whether you want to call it development. Okay, and there's your color chooser. So if we apply that now, Reconnect, yes, doesn't matter. I'm not sure why this is not now working. I mean, this. Oh, I know why. Okay. Let's just make this active again. Okay, but this. Okay, but now if you. Let's see. Okay, but this, okay, if it's working correctly, this at the back should, or this black at the bottom here should now have been that yellow color that we selected. I'm not sure why it's not working now. Okay, any other questions?
I think you left your database to local. You created the new group, but you didn't assign it.
It might, okay, it might be, yeah.
The function where you got the epoch, where you can calculate or get a displayed column, is that built in set, or can you define your own, just call your own SQL function there?
No, that's okay. That's built in functionality. I haven't found a way to do your own custom value. I would have liked, there's other places where I would like, yes, to do that as well, but yes,
okay.
It's built in types that you select there.
So we've been looking for alternatives to pgAdmin for a while now, and I'm sure we're not alone in that. What other products have you tried out before settling on dBeaver?
Oh, I can't remember. It's quite, there was a few that I looked at. Let me just quickly check if I still have them downloaded somewhere. I know, for example, and I don't know if it's still an active project, there was something called Squirrel quite a few years ago. I don't know if that one is still active, but it's the same concept as well, that it's using JDBC drivers. Sorry? Okay, OmniDB. Yeah, there's the data grip part. If even if you've actually got the IntelliJ IDE, even if you've got, say, use it for the Java development, I think part of that built-in database development tools that they've got with it is actually part of data grip as well. But data grip is a standalone product for database development then. No, I actually don't have anything else that I've installed listed anymore. There wasn't really anything else that there's, you'll find SQL Workbench for MySQL, but it's MySQL specific. I haven't seen anything generic like this one in terms of handling all the different RDMS stuff that is available. Okay. Yes, yeah. So, yeah, this big, yeah. The SQL languages differ slightly, but yes. There's another one. Oh, okay.
We've also used an app called NaviCat. It's pretty cheap. I don't know if you guys have tried that out. Yeah. Yeah, we've also. Regarding this theme, I mean, we've been using dBeaver. I don't even know you can change it to a dark theme. Are there theme plugins, or
yes?
Do you know where it is? Is it? Is there somewhere where you download it?
It's. What I think is, I know Eclipse very well. That's why But even if you on the Java, we okay. So you need to okay. I don't have an internet connection here now. But if you can, what's it called? I think darkest themes. So okay, it's developed by DevStyle. They've got a lot of color themes and stuff. So if you go and look at a marketplace, or just go and search on the for Eclipse DevStyle darkest theme and stuff, it will give you an update URL that you can use then to install it. What you can also do if you don't want to use dbeaver as a standalone application, you can actually also install it as a plugin in Eclipse. So you've got then you've got everything built in and you've got all your other plugins available as well. Any other questions? Right, thank you.